Hi, today I have a thermal imaging camera from Kaiweets and I'll be testing it to determine if it's worth investing in or if it's just a niche product with limited value for makers like us. I have been wanting to get a thermal camera for a while and we'll talk more about that later in the video. The packaging has a magnet. By the way, I think the magnets make packaging feel more satisfying. If you want to create cool packaging, add some magnets. And I guess this is the user manual. And under this, you have your thermal camera. On the right, you have only the charging cables. We have finally made it. This is the main part we'll be looking into today. It's a handheld version of the series, and the storage package is decent too, so I'd say it's worth keeping. I wanted to dive right into my first impressions. I even made some herbal tea for the occasion. We also have thermal cameras at my workplace, so I can say already I have a fair bit of experience with them. It may not be a fair comparison to expect the same features from this cheap thermal camera, but I still think we can expect decent results within its specs. And it took about 10 seconds to boot up. While it is booting up, I should mention that thermal cameras are usually tools that people are a bit intimidated to use. And let me show you why. For example, this thermal camera from Fluke, which is actually one of their lowest end models, has the same infrared resolution. It does have some extra features like touchscreen, and I think it has manual focus instead of fixed one as well, so you can get clearer views and such. But in the end, aside from that, it's basically the same as one that I am sharing you right now. As you can see, its price is about a month's salary for me. And that's what usually scares people away from using them. You worry that you might break it by accident, and while they probably won't fire you for that, there is still a chance you could be seen as the person who broke an expensive tool. And here is the one we have at my workplace. I am not touching that unless I absolutely have to. There are also cheaper ones that work with your phone, and I am sure they work fine, but they just feel more like toys than actual tools. I prefer my equipment to be standalone without needing to rely on my phone if possible. If you are curious about the price that I've got, it's around $250 with the current discounts. Right now, it's not showing anything because I need to open the protective cover, obviously. Also, booting up took around like 10 seconds. The LCD seems a little dark for the camera. Let me see if I can adjust it using just one hand. I think it's important to be able to change all the settings with one hand when needed. I guess this is better. To put it simply, thermal cameras detect infrared radiation, essentially heat emitted by the objects, and convert it into a visual image that shows temperature differences. They usually work best when there are temperature differences because without them, you won't be able to see the objects clearly. Let me show you a better example. The room is completely dark right now and I can't see anything. I wonder if you can guess what I am looking at with the thermal camera. I'll give you a few seconds. Alright, time's up. Let me turn on the lights and see what we have been looking at. We have been looking at my two budgies the whole time, and they're a bit startled by the sudden change in the lighting. As you can see, we could easily spot both of them in the dark. That's also why the military uses this technology to detect human presence. I'll leave them alone for now, since they are pretty shocked, and I don't want to disturb them anymore. Sorry about that, buddies. Another cool thing about thermal cameras is they can show a thermal trail. For example, if I move the cup to a different spot, it will leave a thermal trail as you can see here. This is especially useful for detecting moving parts. For example, if you are working on something like a train moving on rails, even if there is no obvious temperature difference, the friction will leave a thermal trail. You can use this feature for early troubleshooting, plan maintenance ahead of time, and keep the machines running smoothly. Neat. I also figured out how to take pictures and videos with it. All you need to do is press the trigger button once, and if you press it once, it asks you if you want to save the screen as a photo. If you hold it, it asks you if you want to start recording the screen as a video. I think from now on, I'll record the thermal videos directly on the device instead of holding it like this, and overlay the recording on the screen alongside the regular video. That way, I believe it will be easier for you to follow along. Before diving into practical application, I want to mention two important things about thermal cameras, and this applies even to the high-end models. Both are easier to demonstrate using aluminum foil. First thing is related to the emissivity, which is basically how effective a material's surface is at emitting energy as thermal radiation. It varies for different materials, and while you can adjust it in the settings, you need to be aware of it. Otherwise, you might misinterpret the readings. The second thing is that shiny surfaces, like mirrors or shiny metals, reflect thermal radiation. As you can see in the thermal image, it looks like some spots on the foil have much higher temperatures than the rest, while other small spots appear much cooler. But if you are dealing with a complex shiny surface, this trick doesn't always work. Let me show you what I mean by wrinkling this aluminum foil. The more complex the area, the weirder and more unusual the readings on the thermal camera become, and causing incorrect results on the screen. I'll wrinkle the aluminum foil with my hands as much as I can to create more complex area. Then I'll check if I can create a similar surface to better demonstrate what I am talking about. For example, from this angle, there are a few spots marked as red in the thermal image. If I try to fix it by changing the angle of the foil, it just creates other spots with incorrect readings. There is no way for aluminum foil to have certain spots heat up and suddenly get colder just by changing the angle. I have another trick for situations like this. People often recommend using black electrical tapes, which works fine for mirrors and similar surfaces, but it's not great at quickly transferring heat. Instead, I use matte painted metal tapes, like this copper one or aluminum one. Either one works fine. I only have this copper tape with me right now, so I'll paint it with the matte black paint. As it is now, since it's shiny, it will also cause misleading readings. Here is a piece I painted black. I just painted one of the copper tapes, but you can also get the ones that already came with a black painted surface. If you prefer, you can use those instead. All you need to do is stick it properly onto shiny surface and read the temperature from the tape. You definitely don't want to cover the entire surface with tape. I'd only stick it on the areas where I need to take measurements. The reason is you get better readings without any tape or similar material in the way. But in cases like this, you have to use it, otherwise you'd be baffled with the oil weird readings that I showed earlier. I didn't paint it perfectly with the random spray paint that I had lying around, but for the sake of this demonstration, it should be fine. As you can see, right after sticking the tape, the temperature reading on it immediately got fixed. You can still see wild readings on the right side, like 30, even 40 degrees or so. So using a tape definitely helps get better readings on shiny or reflective surfaces with a thermal camera. Now let's talk about why I recommend using a metal tape instead of electrical tape. The main reason is that it transfers the heat much faster. For example, when I move my finger behind it, you can see it on the thermal camera right away, and it shows the exact spot where I place my finger. That said, it's your choice. Electrical tape works fine for most situations too, but it's just a bit slower. Even though I have mentioned a lot of precautions and things to watch out when using a thermal camera, it's actually very easy to use. You just turn it on and point at the area you want to measure. I don't even bother changing the emissivity settings. I just check the thermal differences. If you need more accurate measurements for a specific critical point, you can always use traditional methods like thermistor or something. But with those traditional methods, you can't easily get an overall sense of the thermal characteristic of an area. For example, I quickly learned how the heating pipes are laid out under my bathroom and other rooms, and I even found the junctions in seconds. It's also super easy to detect leaks. If a heating pipe starts leaking, you can pinpoint the exact spot instead of tearing up the entire floor. Checking the thermal efficiency of the heating system or the insulation quality of my house wasn't the main reason I wanted a thermal camera. For those purposes, you can just borrow one from a friend or rent it, since you'll probably only need it once or twice. The main reason I wanted one was for troubleshooting in my electronics hobby. It makes finding issues so much easier. What used to take me hours to figure out, I can now identify in seconds. For example, here is a board I am currently working on for one of my future videos. When I connect it to USB, it gets unusually hot, which isn't normal. I wanted to find the root cause, but it was tricky because the ground plane was distributing the heat across the PCB, so I couldn't pinpoint it by touch. Let's see if I can find the issue by using the thermal camera. I connected it to the power supply and I can already see some components heating up immediately. I don't remember the code I programmed into the MCU, but that shouldn't matter much right now. This angle isn't great for the thermal camera, so let's adjust it to get a clearer view. There are three spots heating up more than the rest of the board, so I can focus on checking those three components. The top one is a transistor, which shouldn't be powering up anything with the current code I programmed into the microcontroller, so it shouldn't be heating up at all. The middle one is the ESP32 microcontroller. I can expect some heat here, but there might be something like a solder bridge or leftover solder paste causing it to heat up. The bottom one is the voltage regulator, so it's normal for that component to heat up a bit. Let's move the PCB closer to the camera so you can get a better view. I cleaned the PCB with alcohol after soldering, but after a closer look, it still seems a bit dirty, especially on the transistor side. I think I mixed two different types of solder paste and the water-soluble one didn't clean up well. I'll clean it again and check it. As a side note, the temperature here isn't 14 degrees Celsius, it's closer to 22. The reason the thermal camera shows a different temperature is due to the factors that I mentioned earlier. I could adjust the emissivity settings to correct it, but honestly I don't really care. Now I've cleaned it with some water and plugged it into USB power supply again. I don't think there should be any issues with the cleaning now. The transistor isn't showing any unusual heat increase now, so I think the issue with it was resolved by just cleaning it properly. And here's a lesson I have learned. Don't mix different types of fluxes. It makes cleaning way too difficult. The ESP32 and the voltage regulator are still heating up, but that's expected since the ESP32 isn't exactly known for being energy efficient. Let's move on to the next case, which I am really curious about. You might remember from the previous video that my Ender 3D printer got broke. I did check the power supply and it works just fine. I don't think the LCD is the issue, as they are usually very reliable components. Most likely we have an issue on the main board here. And I was putting off finding the root cause because this kind of problems usually take a lot of time. Let me see if I can find any clues about the problem using the thermal camera. I'll hold it in my hand and move around the motherboard to get a better viewing angle. I'll plug the power supply into the wall outlet and try to start it. I can already see something is heating up. I wonder which component it is. And the temperature is rising very rapidly. This is definitely not normal. The temperature keeps rising. Then it rose about 100 degrees Celsius in just a few seconds. And the part heating up so rapidly is the microcontroller. If I wait any longer, it might cause additional issues on the board. So I will just stop for now. I removed the main board from the 3D printer and there is no visible damage on it other than the microcontroller. This is an 8-bit old board and it has Atmega 1284P on it. The damage on the MCU isn't immediately visible, but if I move it closer to the camera, I think you'll be able to see it too. I was expecting the step motor drivers or the transistor to be the issue, but their temperatures didn't rise. It might be due to the heat sinks on them, but I'll know for sure after replacing the microcontroller. I have already ordered the exact replacement. It cost me around $5. I placed it under my microscope and the damage is very clear. It is completely fried. I am going to remove it. I am soldering the new one that I have ordered earlier. Overall, it took me around 10 minutes to replace it. Just replacing the MCU is not enough, of course. I need to install the bootloader and also firmware on it. I have an USB ASP that I can use, but of course you can use other tools like Arduino Uno or something similar as well. I uploaded the bootloader and the firmware on it. The MCU isn't heating up anymore, but there is still something else getting warm. It's the step motor driver for the X-axis. I can see it is heating up under the heatsink. The step motor driver is heating up even though it is idle. I should definitely look into it more closely, but this video has become long enough, so I will leave it for now. Let's talk about the real question. Do you really need a thermal camera? It depends on who you are and your interests. Even if you are not into this hobby, you might still find a use like checking the insulation or hidden heating pipe leaks at home. But for that, it may not be worth buying one. You could simply rent it for a day or borrow it from a friend. If you are interested in electronics or this hobby in general, it depends on your level. If you are just starting, there are a few essentials you should consider getting first. In that case, you don't need this type of equipment right away. If you are thinking about starting this hobby, you should spend your money on buying a few Arduino boards, or maybe a few ESP boards for Wi-Fi applications, or even better, a Raspberry Pi. You can do so many cool projects with all those. I would say that's the first level. You can also get a few more sensors, actuators, or servo motors, etc. Next, you might consider getting a 3D printer, maybe even as a Christmas gift for yourself. This is the controller board that I had broke, but it brought me so much fun and enjoyment. After playing with those for a while, you'll realize you can do much more than those tools can provide. You might want to create custom PCBs. Not only can they offer more functionality with the component selection, but they'll also make your project significantly cheaper. However, you will indeed come to see some issues, and troubleshooting can take so much time. It can be fun to find the issues, let's say during the first time or the second time. However, you will see them quite often. Then it might be quite frustrating. For example, this project of mine took so much time for troubleshooting, and I know there are a few mistakes that I made. However, since it took me weeks to tackle down all the issues manually, I lost interest on continuing this project. If I had a thermal camera back then, I might find the motivation to complete this project. But now, I don't even want to take a look at it because of the pain it caused me. And the last question, which still needs to be answered. Is it worth buying this thermal camera? You can, of course, buy a high-end thermal camera, which provides better functionality and resolution. It might even come with the lenses that could help achieve better focus. But they are quite pricey. You can also go cheaper, but I prefer a standalone handheld device, like I mentioned earlier. And I don't like the ones you can attach to your phone and use an app for the terminal view. They are not practical, and there is always the risk that their service can be discontinued, making the app unusable. For a standalone device like this, even if the company goes bankrupt, you can still use the tool that you have bought. For the frustration and the time saved alone, a budget thermal camera can definitely be worth having. It is not the first tool you should buy, of course. A decent multimeter should come first, but for most makers, a thermal camera can be a valuable tool for their projects. I believe I can use it effectively in the future to easily spot annoying mistakes I've made and focus more on enjoyable tasks. If you like this video, don't forget to give a thumbs up, and see you next time.